Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 38, recorded on the 30 September 2016. We're indoor again today because it's still misty and rainy and windy, as you see. But as a compensation, I brought a candle, a live candle, to make it kind of like more cozy. Cozy Dhamma is the subject today. There are five questions, but first the normal intro, as usual. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. The first question, number 120, goes like this. Can a stream entrant fall back into a lower state? And question B, which defilement has a stream entrant eradicated? First, can a stream entrant fall into a lower state? No, they cannot fall into a lower state. And that's actually the largest advantage with early Buddhism compared to other religions, because early Hinduism, with its advanced meditation, can possibly take the individual up to level 12, 13, and 14 of the 31 levels of existence. That is the first three levels of the Brahma Loka. We are in the Kama Loka, level 1 to 11, and humans are level 5. Christianity and also Islam and other religions can also take people to a so-called heaven, not heaven in the eternal sense or almighty sense, but a higher level of existence with higher degrees of freedom and pleasure and sophistication than the human level. So they can take up to level 10, where we are level 5, by the practice of giving and by the practice of moral purity. However, these attainments are not stable in the sense that after the good karma of these practices, meditation, morality, and giving and helping, giving service to others, help them, then they can fall back here to back to the human state. And even lower than the human state, they can become an animal, an angry demon, a hungry ghost, or even a hell being. So this means that all non-global attainments, even the divine, are unstable. In that sense, it's worth noticing that you yourself, you who watch this video, have been a deva, have been in the divine levels billions of times, yet, of course, without remembering it. Now you're here. You're back to square one. So it doesn't, this is the main difference, that you don't go back to square one when you become noble for the first time in your samsaric career. From there on, there's only seven lives left, and one is bound to, one has entered the stream to nirvana, full freedom, absolute peace, and the supreme highest happiness. One is destined, luck in that destiny, with seven lives at most to be experienced before Nibbana. This makes this attainment safe, while attainments, even the best ideal attainments in the Hindu, Christian and Islamic traditions and other traditions also, which emphasize meditation, morality, giving and helping, these are not safe in the sense that they are unstable on the very long time run scale. that is millions of billions of years. But nevertheless, they are still unstable. So you cannot trust them in the ultimate sense. However, the noble stage from Sotapanna is only one step up. Then is once returner, Sakadagami. One step up again, Anagami. One step up, enlightened Arahant. So you can never go a step down. You can only step up. Stay at the same level or step up. So it's an unidirectional way, the noble way. It is not up and then down later, all the way down to animal or hell. It's only up. And that's a major difference. That makes Buddhist practice safe in the absolute sense. Which defilements has a stream entrant eradicated? Stream entrant is a sotapanna in Pali. Sota means stream. And panna entry. A sota can means too that you had entered the stream too that leads to nirvana, just like a small mountain streams rounding down into the river, and then it leads to the ocean. So the consciousness also it streams towards nirvana, towards becoming non-personal and non-local, just like the water in the streamlet streams toward the ocean, where it becomes mixed with all the other water in the endless ocean. There are three kinds of sotapannas that can be distinguished. There's a one passing from one noble family to another noble family. They're called Kolankola. They have seven lives left. Then there's one germinating only once more. They are Ikkabichi. One cedars. If a human, after the disappearance of the three fetters, samyujanas, the three mental change, one personality belief, sakaya ditti, which is basically the belief in that I am these five clusters of clinging. We'll take this in detail a little down the road. Then other fetter is skeptical doubt, vichikicca. A third one in clinging to mere rules and ritual. Sirabhatta Paramasa. Such one who has eradicated these three, he has entered the stream to Nibbana. He is no more subject to rebirth in the lower worlds. That is, he cannot be an animal. He cannot become a hungry ghost, a demon, or a hell being. And he is firmly established, destined for full, complete enlightenment. After having passed amongst heavenly and human beings only seven times more, through the round of rebirth, he puts an end to suffering. Such a human is called one with seven births at most. Satarakattu Parama. The second type is, if a human after the disappearance of the three fetters is destined to full enlightenment, he, after having passed among good families two or three times through the round of rebirths, puts an end to suffering. Such a human is called one passing from one noble family to another, Kolankola. If a human, after the disappearance of the three fetters, is destined for full enlightenment, yet only comes back to this existence only once more, he returns to this human existence. Then he puts an end to suffering. Such a human is called one germinating once more, a one seeder, a single seeder, Ikkabichi, bija seed, Ikka one, Ikkabichi, one seeder, one germinator. This is a whole, the Samyutta Nikaya is a whole section, sizes of a finger. There's a Suttapati Samyutta, it's number 55. And this one is a small book about stream entry. So therefore, I recommend you buy this volume, Samyutta Nikaya, the Connected Discourses of the Buddha, and read what he has said about it. I also give the links below. I have something like 25 Dhamma drops on stream entry, how you to attain it, how the helpers are to it, how the approach are to it, how to recognize it. I give this link below this video. let's go into these three fetters that are binding beings below. The first are the Sakaya Ditti, the self-belief. So there's what a being is, according to Buddhism, is a process of five things, five streaming things. Namely, form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness. This is a being, a sentient being, a conscious being, a satta. So if this conscious being projects or identifies with any of these five, projects a self onto these five streams of one, material, the body, the form, and four mental processes. If he projects in these 20 kind of ways, I'll come to in detail here, then he has not broken the Sakaya Ditti. You can, while you listen to this, you can try to analyze and be honest, brutally honest with yourself. Do I ascribe to one of these views? What are the 20 invalid theories of an only apparently existing ego self? One, myself is identical with my body. This physical matter of my body is my ego, is myself. This is first wrong view. Second is, myself has a body. This physical matter is owned by my ego. So it's ownership of the body, that's the ego. Myself is hidden somewhere inside and included within this body frame. So the body is, the self is in the brain, or the self is in the heart, or as the Greek, they thought there was a homunculus, a small man within the big man that was kind of like controlling him as a robot, as a small agent within the large robot. That's, of course, not the case. This body form is hidden inside and included within an all-pervading ego. It's a Hindu thought, the Atman, that all are the same and all are me, I am that, umtvat. So this body is, since this body is a member of this material universe, then this body is also the ego, the self. Number five, wrong view. Myself is identical with my feelings. Pain, pleasure, and neutral feeling is myself, is my ego. Myself has feelings. These sensations are owned by my very own ego. Seven, myself is hidden inside among these feelings, included within these emotions. These feelings are hidden inside and included within an all-pervading ego self. So again, four kinds of wrong view. Either one identifies with the object, feeling, form, feeling, perception, mental construction, or consciousness. Or one says one has ownership about it. Or one is hidden about, what the self is hidden inside them somewhere. Or included inside it. Or that the self is included in somewhere bigger. They are included in something bigger that also is this self. Number nine, wrong view. Myself is identical with my perceptions. These experiences are my ego. That includes memories. My memories are myself. That is my personality. It's a summation of my memories. It's a very common thing to believe in. Myself has owns perceptions. These experiences are owned by my very own ego. Myself is hidden inside these perceptions among all these experiences. 12. These experiences are hidden inside and included inherently within my ego self. 13. Myself is identical with my mental constructions. My ideas and intentions are my ego. Myself possess mental constructions. These activities, mental activities, are owned by my ego. Myself is hidden inside among these mental constructions, included as a core. These cogitations are hidden inside and included inherently within my ego self. So basically, this one says, I am my hopes, my intentions, my mental constructions, my ideations, my illusions, my self-deceptions, and so on. This is myself. not seeing that this depositing ourselves within these mental activities is itself a self-deception. So it's an illusory self that deceives itself about itself and its own fake existence. 17. Here's the difficult ones. Myself is identical with my consciousness. This bare awareness is my ego. Okay, we shut down the consciousness. Doing sleeping, doing anesthesia. Then the self is gone. Where does it go when you sleep? Then it comes back or what? So you see, the self cannot be the consciousness. Then is it going to the toilet when you are in surgery, doing anesthesia or what? The self. If it were equal to consciousness, then you should say like that. Huh? Myself has consciousness. This naked awareness is owned by my ego. Myself is hidden inside this consciousness, included in all aware moments. This consciousness is hidden inside and included inherently within myself. Why are these very 20 very common assumptions invalid and wrong and false and erroneous? Because any concept of a self implies three crucial criteria. One, sameness. So it should be the same self all the time. It should be identical with itself from one moment to the next moment. If it becomes something else or someone else, this self, then this concept of self breaks down. So sameness is one criteria. It should be something constant over time and something, an identical same self. The second criteria is control, autonomy. That is, the self can control itself. It's fully independent. And there one can see no self can control themselves. Unless you are awakened, you cannot determine whether you want to have pleasure or pain, whether you want to understand this or not. These circumstances, choosing that, mixed a cacophonic concert of circumstances. So also, if the self has pain, then it cannot burn the finger, for example, on the candle here. And then it cannot say to itself, now I don't want to experience self or any pain. So if the self was in control, then it could do this trick, say, I don't experience any pain. But then we can conclude that it is not in control. If the self is not in control of itself, is it then, who is then in control? Then whatever that is, these circumstances, then they must be the self. They are more valid as a self. But they are external circumstances, so this is very difficult. Past, present, and future. So, because this autonomy, control, criteria also falls. So, the first criteria was that it's the same. No self is the same from one moment to the next moment. So there is no self. Then was criteria of control. No self is in control, complete, absolute control. So therefore also, it cannot be a self. The last thing is that it should be pleasant. If it could make itself pleasant and happy, it could make eternal lasting happiness if it were in control. But since it cannot do that, we can conclude that the self is not in power. It's not in control of itself. And since it's not in control of itself, we have to ask this question, who or what is then in control? Then that must be the self. So since these three criteria falls for any self you deposit, then there cannot be any self. The first mechanism is you say, myself is identical to my body, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness. This is an unseen and assumed associative ego projection. So it's just, it's kind of like there's a thing. I could also project my ego or say, this candlelight is myself. It's burning all the time, changing all the time. It lights up everything just as my awareness, just as my consciousness. So it's a projection of to something. This, now I'm projecting it to something external. But when I say this body is myself, and these feelings are myself, these experiences, perceptions are myself, all these mental constructions, hopes, intentions, longings, and plannings, these are myself, or this consciousness is myself, then I am doing the exact same thing. I'm projecting a self onto something that is not self. First of all, because it's not identical with itself, the sameness criteria falls for all, because of impermanence. In impermanence, nothing is identical with itself from one moment to the next moment. There's always change to be seen. So the next one, so the example of an illusory identification with passing states, impersonal states. The next one you say is that I own. The self has a body. It has feelings. They have ownership over the feelings and the experiences and the perceptions and the constructions and the consciousness. The self owns them, like money in the bank. So this is an example of a fictitious immanence, an invented ownership. I don't say I own this candlelight, nor this body, because I know I cannot take it with me to death, and not even, probably not even tomorrow, because then this candle is burned down. And I might have a heart attack tonight. Huh? So this is hypothetically the last video. But let's see. But you never know. You never know. So this ownership is illusory in all cases, whether internal or external, past, present, or future, whether self or not self. There's no ownership over anything whatsoever in the absolute degree. The other thing is to say myself is inside, is hidden inside my body, or among my feelings, perception, mental constructions, or is hidden inside somewhere, inside my consciousness. This is an example of imagined inclusion in something becoming otherwise. So the thing is included and becomes otherwise. But how can a thing then that is hidden inside it, not other, also become otherwise? Huh? That's a little difficult to understand. So if the thing itself, the body itself, the consciousness itself becomes otherwise, then this self that is included, hidden, inside, immanent inside these things, assumed to be immanent inside these things, these phenomena, changing phenomena, then this must also change. If it's changed, it falls for the sameness criteria. The last one is kind of like a phony possessing of something, an invisible acquisition, that I'm a part of a bigger ego, an Atman ego. I'm a part of everything, and the ego, and the everything is the self, the ego. And since I'm a part of that, Umtvat, then I must also have a self. Neither of them is actually feasible. So these are the 20 kinds of false ego projection onto something that is merely a passing physical or mental state. Then the next one, I hope that your hindrance, your fetter, your samyoyana on this kind of speculation or assumption, your sakaya ditti, your personality belief has been rattled a little bit here and maybe even evaporated. Hopefully so. The Buddha said that the highest bliss simply is the evaporation and irreversible eradication of this conceit that I am, I exist. There's an I, an ego that exists all the time. That's not the case. That's not the case. There's only circumstances passing that comes and goes and interacts with each other. So the second hindrance was skeptical doubt, vichikicca. Skeptical doubt is one of the five mental hindrances, Nivarana, and also one of the three fetters, Samyujana, which disappear at stream entry forever. And stream entry is the first stage of being a noble person, Arya Bhukkala. This skeptical doubt, on a deep down level, it refers to being skeptical about whether the Buddha, he really was perfectly self-enlightened or not. And this then spills over in whether he speaks absolute Dhamma or not, absolute true Dhamma or not, absolute good Dhamma or not, absolute advantageous Dhamma or not. And then this spills over into whether the Sangha is really unsurpassable, good or not. This also spills in about that whether the training, Buddhist mental training, is absolute. Thinks about whether the past or the future are so and not so. And thinks about whether things are conditioned, that is, dependent origination. Codependent, co-origination. The principle of this causality. When this arises, that also arises. When this ceases, that also ceases. This law, doubting about that law, doubting about the Buddha, doubting about the Dhamma, doubting about the Sangha, the Arya Sangha, the noble Sangha, not the whole Sangha, but only the part of the Sangha that is noble. Doubting about that, that is skeptical doubt. So it also applies to uncertainty, whether things are advantageous or not, good or bad, whether things are to be practiced or not, whether things are to be done or not, whether things are of high or of low value. So it says the whole question of graduated evaluation. So skeptical doubt about that, that's skeptical doubt. Visuddhimagga says that path of purification, I'll give the link below, that is a lack of desire to think out things, to come to a conclusion. It's a lack of desire to scrutinize, to examine, and ponder. So it has the nature of wavering, and its manifestation is indecisiveness. One cannot really decide the matter, so one remains wavering around, fooling around in indecisiveness, and in a divided, ambivalent attitude. Its proximate cause is irrational attention, ayuniso, manasikara, to matters of doubt, questionable matters. How to cure this hesitant, skeptical doubt and uncertainty? The Buddha says, noticing doubt and uncertainty, emerge. This can make it fade away. Here in bhikkhus, when doubt and uncertainty is present in a bhikkhu, the bhikkhu notes and understands and labels. There's doubt and uncertainty in me. And then this doubt and uncertainty is absent, then he similarly notices, labels, and understands. Now, no doubt and uncertainty is in me. He also fully understands how unarising doubt and uncertainty arises. He also understands how to leave behind any already arising or arisen doubt and uncertainty. And he understands how left and eliminated doubt and uncertainty will not arise ever again in the future. Vajjamanikaya number 10. What is the cause that feeds doubt and uncertainty? What does doubt and uncertainty burn on? What does it burn on? What is this fuel? There are doubtful, unclear, indeterminate, and inconclusive ambiguities, often giving irrational and unwise attention to such matters is the feeding cause of the arising of yet absent doubt and uncertainty, and the feeding cause also of worsening and aggravation of any doubt and uncertainty that already has emerged. Samyutta Nikaya 46:51. So he basically says, for example, if the question that cannot be determined is whether the space is infinite or not, cannot be determined. And also whether time is infinite or not, backward and forward, cannot be determined. So one should not speculate upon that. And there's thousands of similar matters that is doubtful and questionable, and one cannot ever come to a conclusion. Given such matters, such questions, such aspects, irrational attention, because it is irrational since that they cannot be determined in the first place. So speculating about that, this grows doubt, uncertainty, of course. What is the starving cause that makes doubt and uncertainty cease, makes it fade away and evaporate? There are advantageous and detrimental states, blamable and blameless, average and excellent, and dark and bright states, frequently giving rise to these states. Is a starting course for prevention of arising doubt and uncertainty. And the starving course also for the elimination of doubt and uncertainty that already have appeared. So one considers this for all things in life, internal, external, whether you do it yourself or somebody else do it, or whether it's something you see or something you think, anything you consider from this four criteria. Is it advantageous or disadvantageous? First. Is it blameless or blameable? Is it ordinary or exalted? Is it on the bright side or on the light side? So these criteria make the line in the sand between good and bad, between high and low, between right and wrong, is more and more narrow. So we come to a more and more fine discrimination about where actually the borderline is and when it is stepped over, when one is on the other side. It's a good lifelong practice to evaluate all phenomena. Are they advantageous or detrimental? Are they blameless or blamable? Are they ordinary, banal, or are they exalted, subtle, fine? Are they on the bright side or on the dark side? This will evaporate doubt, this scrutinization over a long period. There are also six other things to throw out doubt. The state of being learned in the Buddha Dhamma diminishes doubt. Examining the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha helps getting rid of doubt. Understanding the advantageousness of moral discipline evaporates doubt. Being decided and convinced about the three jewels, the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha, makes skeptical doubt fade away. Having sympathetic, clever, and helpful friends who know what they talk about also helps reduce doubt and uncertainty. Examining and explaining talk and teachings that can dispel doubt, such as this one, this also helps doubt to go away. Doubt and uncertainty is like a desert. It's just when a rich man, he travels through a desolate desert when there's no food and much danger. Freedom from doubt and uncertainty is like when he has crossed the desert and gradually reaches a safety near a village, a secure place, free from danger. There he is relieved. Dikkha Nikaya number 2, said the Buddha. Doubt and uncertainty is a danger because it locks the individual into lameness, into non-action. Why is it so? Because it's like an individual is inside a round room with 100 doors, but he doesn't know what's behind the doors, all these opportunities, possibilities to do this and that, which actually is more than 100 doors in each second, there's these opportunities to do this and to do that. But since you don't know the consequence in advance, then which door to pick? There can be an atomic bomb behind one door and a birthday cake behind the next door. You cannot know if you don't know what is behind the doors. So it locks the individual into inactivity, into indecisiveness. So it is when doubt about one of eight objects of doubt has arisen, doubting whether the master really is perfectly enlightened or not. One cannot become assured of it with confidence. Unconvinced, one remains unable to attain the path and the fruits of nobility. Thus, as a traveler in the desert is uncertain whether robbers there are not, he produces his mind again and again, a state of wavering, vacillation, instability, a lack of decision, a state of anxiety. And thus he creates in himself an obstacle for reaching the safe ground of the noble ones, Arya Bhumi. In that way is skeptical doubt like a traveling in a barren and dry desert. So whether robbers are there or not, it's still a desert, this doubt. Doubt and uncertainty can only be indecisive about which action to choose and thus paralyze the skeptic by hesitancy, leaving the problem unsettled and unsolved. Doubt can only be eliminated by frequently examining and scrutinizing the object or the aspect. Once an elderly, doubtful Brahmin priest, he approached the Buddha, he was called Dottaka, and said to him, I see here in the world of beings, divine and human, good ones, who live simply by possessing nothing. I thus bow for you all around, I. Sakyan, please release me from my doubt. So he comes to ask the Buddha, who is much younger than him, to release him from his doubt. The Buddha, then he answers, no one in this world, Dottaka, can ever release from doubt. But knowing this most excellent Dhamma, you can cross this raving ocean of vacillating uncertainty. So the Buddha says to him, I cannot do it for you. Your gods cannot do it for you. The Dhamma, only the Dhamma can do it for you. Get rid of your doubt. I'll teach you that peace even right here. Not that just hearsay. Understanding this, living aware and detached, you will go beyond the incarcerating entanglement of this world. Then Dottaka, of course, say, teach me as your friend, O best one, the Dhamma of detachment, so I may know directly, so that I, as unaffected as space itself, may live right here, at ease, in peace, calmed, stilled, and not dependent on anything. Then the Buddha says, whatever you are aware of, Dottaka, above, below, across, or in between. Know this as a chain to this world. Something that binds. Thus do not create any craving for any form of being's existence. Do not develop any craving for any form of new becoming, becoming this and that tomorrow or later. Down the road. Do neither develop any craving for any kind of non-becoming. Sutta Nipata, number 5, number 6. Craving for non-becoming would be, may I not become dead, may I not become old, may I not become sick, may I not become poor, may I not become criticized, and so forth. So I hope this clears up some doubt about what doubt and uncertainty is and how to get around it. Then there's the last one, is clinging to mere rules and rituals. Silabhata paramasa. So this is clinging to all kinds of rules. For example, if you're standing in front of a red light, then you say, I cling to the rule, don't go if it's red light. Then a car comes from behind and drive you down on the, there on the pedestrian area. So this is sticking to the rule there in this case, which is the right rule normally, but not in this case, that drives you down. Or you get in the, out in your car, and then without thinking about it, you have decided to go somewhere else. You drive to your workplace because it's habitual tendency, a rule or a ritual gets you there to your workplace, despite you had determined, and then unawareness also, to go somewhere else. Or one, a monk, he learns to sweep when in an office, and then he keeps sweeping all his life. He never meditates because he thinks sweeping is like meditation. Or one who does prostration, or burning candles, or incense sticks, or things like that. All this can make me holy. This is also clinging to mere rules, ritual. They are empty and irrelevant practices that one elevates to something more than they are. They are practical. One should look at them pragmatically, but not elevate them to more than that they are. I think this, again, this answer question 20, there's these three fetters that bind personality belief, sakkaya ditti, skeptical doubt, vichikicca, and clinging to mere rules and rituals, silabhata paramasa. When they are gone, one is a stream entrant, destined for nibbana within 7 lifetimes. So be it. That's your way. That's your chance. Question number 121 is, how can one combat mara, evil and ill will? Yes, one can combat mara simply by, first of all, being aware of his influence and accepting it as it is, that he can influence not only mara but many other beings can influence one's thoughts and do it almost incessantly. So seeing this, that one is pushed in the back and influenced by other beings, not only mara but also other beings, also good ones. I'm influencing you now, and I was influenced by the Buddha, so telling you this is actually an influence comes from Gautama Buddha. And to him it comes from an endless row of other Buddhas. They bring the Dhamma and uphold the Dhamma. Dhamma Dara, upholding the Dhamma. But it's the gradual reduction of greed, hate, and ignorance, lobha, dosa, and avidya, through a steady and stable insistence on the Noble Eightfold Way that keeps mara at bay. So one keeps coming back to the Four Noble Truths and the Noble Eightfold Way, never giving up. Then gradually one will weaken the influence that mara has over one's mind. So one sticks to the Four Noble Truths, and hereby also, right view, right motivation, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right awareness, and right concentration, culminating in right release and right knowledge and vision of release. How to overcome ill will? That's another thing. This is basically done classically with the 5 Brahmavihara, the 5 best dwellings, the 4 infinite states, Appamanna, Brahmavihara, which is first loving kindness. Whatever beings they are, may they be happy. May they be free from enmity. May they be free from all frustration. The other one is compassion and pity, karuna. Whatever beings they are, may they be free from all pain and suffering. Mudita, mutual joy, in other success, is the third. Whatever beings they are, may they enjoy success, richness, health, fame, and respect. Rejoicing in other beings' success, elevation, and richness. And the fourth is equanimity. Whatever beings they are all owners of their karma. They inherit their karma. They are born of their karma, related to their karma, abide supported by their karma. Whatever karma they do, whether good or evil, the effect of that will be theirs only. It started raining outside. Contemplation of infinite loving kindness is like this. Having seen that all beings, whatever, they search only for one thing, that's happiness. Then one cultivate loving kindness like this. May I always be free from suffering and thereby happy. May all my friends always be happy and free from suffering. May all neutral beings always be happy and free from suffering. May all my enemies, difficult one, always be happy and free from suffering. May all my enemies always be happy and free from suffering. That's where metta shines through, beams through. Within this town, this country, this continent, this planet, all galaxies, may all sentient beings, all persons, all creatures, all breathing things be happy, free, joyous, content, jubilant, and without ill will or anger. May they be peaceful in all their various destinies. Whatever living beings there are, be it men, women, nobles, ordinary, animals, devas, or unhappy ones, who lives in one of the 10 directions, whether weak or strong, long or large, small or short, far or near, seen or unseen, in existence or seeking to become this and that, with no exceptions, may all beings be blissful. May they enjoy exceedingly pleasant bliss. May they enjoy. May I be free from enmity. May I be free from distress. May I be free from misery. May I live happily thereby. Whatever beings they are, may they be free from enmity. May they be free from distress. Whatever beings they are, may they be free from misery. May they live happily. May all beings, all breathing things, all creatures, all persons, all living entities, all women, all men, all nobles, all not nobles, all devas, humans, beings in the realm of depurations, hell beings, in the east, west, north, south, above as below, and all around, be free from enmity, be free from pain, be free from all distress, be free from all misery, and be free from all suffering, and thereby live fully and happily. Yeah, that's metta. That's the way ill will goes away. It's an infinite state. So also is compassion. So also is mutual joy. And so also is equanimity. That's the way to eradicate ill will. So much goes for question 121. 122. How to generate merit? In this case, the question goes about higher merit. But we'll take normal merit. Merit is punya, and it can be compared to probability in quantum mechanics today. A probability that is stored out in non-local or across space. So the melody of making merit, making produce this probability that influences all future states for the actor. goes like this. Dana sila bhavana. Dana means giving. Sila means morality. Bhavana means mental development. This was said by the blessed one, the Arahat, so I've heard. There are these three causes for the accumulation of merit. Good probability, good karma. What three? The cause of accumulation of merit made by giving. Two, the cause of accumulation of merit made by moral purity. Five precepts or eight precepts or even more. And the cause for accumulation of merit made by meditative development. These are the three causes for meritorious accumulation. Train in act that brings long-lasting bliss. Develop giving. Train giving. Develop a life in pure morality. Train ethics and morality. And develop a mind of goodwill. Developing these three things will surely bring happiness. So such wise will reappear in a world of unalloyed bliss. Furthermore, the Blessed One explained, doing good like this, here and now the good doer rejoices. Even so, after passing away and re-emerging, this reborn doer of good reaps only joy and satisfaction. So both here and there, the wise, with merit well done, enjoys the purity of their prior good actions. Dhammapada 16. This precious possibility. Just as one can make a many varied bouquets from a single big bunch of flowers, any mortal among the humans can make many kinds of merit by doing many various kinds of good deeds. Flower making. Good making. Dhammapada 53. Honorable. Those who honor those worthy of honor, that is the Buddha and his disciples, who are unhindered, sorrowless and fearless, finders of Nibbana. The merit gained from such worthy and well-directed honor cannot be estimated by anyone. Dhammapada number 105, 95 to 96. To whom should one give to gain most merit? Was the young Brahmin Makka. He once asked the blessed Buddha this question. To whom should one give? When giving food, where would this offering be most purified for the donor? The blessed one then answered, if any open-handed householder, a lordly giver, Makka, seeking merit, looking for merit, sacrifices, giving food or drink to others, such one would achieve the most merit if the recipient is pure and noble. If the recipient is pure and noble. Such who indeed wander unattached in this world, owing and wanting nothing, fully accomplished, in complete self-control, upon them at the right time one should bestow an offering. Those who have cut all mental bonds and fetters, who are tamed, completely released, without affliction, without desire, without longing, without urge. Upon them, at the right time, should one bestow an offering. Upon these purified and noble ones should any Brahmin who is looking for merit place his sacrifice. Sutta Nipata, number 488. To 491. So he basically says, give to those who do not want anything. Give to the nobles. The 10 advantageous actions, good karma, is that also accumulates this merit, this pin, this punya, this probability for the doer or non-doer in the future. There's three bodily advantageous actions, avoidance of all killing, avoidance of all stealing, and avoidance of all abusive sexuality. There's four verbal advantageous actions: avoidance of all lying, avoidance of all slandering, and avoidance of all angry and empty speech. There's three mental advantageous actions: is being motivated for withdrawal, being motivated by goodwill, and being motivated by right views. Majjhima Nikaya number 9. Then there's 10 meritorious actions. We're again talking about normal, mundane merit. Cannot bring you to Nibbana, but it can bring you to a higher state of being than human. 1. Giving, dana. 2. Morality, sila. 3. Meditation, bhavana. 4. Reverence by paying respect to monks and elders. 5. Performing services to others. 6. Transference of merits to others. 7. Rejoicing in others' merit. 8. Learning this true Dhamma. 9. Teaching this true Dhamma. 10. Correcting one's wrong views. This was the mundane merit, normal merit, ordinary merit. Then we go to the higher merit. I give the links below to this, what I have on my website about merit and merit making. Merit is punya in Pali and probability in Western quantum mechanics. Same thing. Higher merit, jhana, and the supermundane understanding of what is not of this world. The Buddha explained the fourfold definition of right concentration, jhana, absorption, appanna samadhi, like this. Having eliminated the 5 mental hindrances, mental defects that obstruct understanding, quite secluded from sensual desires, thus protected from any detrimental mental state, one enters and dwells in the first jhana, full of joy and pleasure, born of solitude, joined with the directed and sustained thought. One makes this joy and pleasure, born of seclusion, drench, saturate, soak, and suffuse this entire body. So there's no part of this body that is unperfused by this intense joy and pleasure. Just as a skilled bathman puts soap powder in a copper basin and sprinkling it gradually with water, whips it until the water soaks and pervades all the soap powder, yet without this foam dripping, so too does a noble friend make the joy and pleasure born of solitude permeate and pervade his entire body. Again, friends, with the stilling of directed and sustained thought, one enters and dwells in the second jhana, a calmed assurance of unification of mind, with even deeper joy and pleasure, now born of concentration, devoid of any thought, empty of any thinking. One makes this exquisite joy and pleasure, born of concentration, drench, saturate, soak, and suffuse this body, so that no part of this entire body that is unperfused by this profound joy and pleasure. Just as a lake whose water wells up from below within itself, and it have no other source, neither by showers of the rain or by any rivers coming down to it, then this cool fount of water welling up from within, deep down in this lake itself, would immense fill and pervade this entire lake. Even and exactly so does one make this joy and pleasure of concentration infuse this entire body. Furthermore, friends, with the fading away of joy, the friend dwells in equanimity, just aware and clearly comprehending, still feeling pleasure in the body. He enters upon and remains in the third jhana, regarding which the noble ones declare, in aware equanimity, one dwells in pleasure. One makes his pleasure apart from joy, flood, saturate, soak, and suffuse the body. So there is no part of one's whole body unperfused by this pleasure, divested of joy. Just as in a lotus pond, some lotuses are born, grow, and thrive, immersed under the water, and the cool water soaks them from their roots to their tips, so too does a noble friend make the pleasure divested of joy drench, fill, flood, and pervade this entire body. Finally, friends, with the leaving behind of both pleasure and pain, and with the prior disappearance of both joy and sorrow, one enters and dwells in the fourth jhana, a completely stilled mental state of awareness, purified by an equanimity of neither pain nor pleasure. One thereby sits illuminating the body internally, as if from inside, with this pure, bright mind. So there's no part of one's whole body not illuminated by this pure, bright mind. Just as a man was sitting covered with head down with a white cloth, so that no part of his body was uncovered by this white textile, even so does one sit encompassing this entire body with a pure, bright and radiant mind. So there's no part of the body not illuminated by this pure, bright, and luminous mind. These four jhanas, training them, attaining them, being in them, emerging from them, is the higher merit, the merit going beyond. This answered the question about merit. There's two more questions, but I think we take them next time because otherwise it'll go more than 1 hour and the candle is burning down. Lastly, I will say I will happy at heart with this series because it answers many questions for many people, including myself. So please keep sending in your questions related to the Dhamma to me, Bhante Samahita, Bhan. te.samahita@gmail.com, and then I'll take them in the order they come in. I also like to say again thank you to the reliable regular donors who contribute every month, and also to the occasional donors, and to those who give food, not the least those who gave food for this month, which keeps this Dhamma expositions flowing to the benefit of the many, also those who come after us. Thinking about it, it's not unrealistic that these videos will be in circulation more than 1 millennia, maybe more than 2 even, because there's 2,500 years of the Dhamma, of the Sasana left. So if these videos can keep flow, then we are keeping up, underpinning, we have become bearers of the Dhamma. And that's very good. So thank you to all the supporters, all the Dhamma Dharas, the bearers, the upholders of the true Dhamma, for the benefit of all beings. Thank you for your attention. Namo Tassa Bhagavato, Arahato, Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Remember to click subscribe and have a nice day.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammāhita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha.